After their final live concert at Candlestick Park in San Francisco on August 29th, 1966, the world's biggest band decided to stop touring to screaming masses of girls who couldn't hear their music anyways. Of course, I am talking about the Beatles, who are often cited as the greatest band of all time. Their eighth studio album is one of the greatest albums of all time, and is one of the best-selling. This is, of course, Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. To go into the history, after their 1966 American tour, which was plagued by John Lennon's "more famous than Jesus" quote, and a cross-burning incident with the Ku Klux Klan, the Fab Four quit touring and went into the studio. Although they had decided not to tour anymore, all four of them took a two-month vacation from being Beatles to go explore their own interests. John Lennon went off to act in the film How I Won the War. Paul McCartney collaborated with George Martin on the soundtrack to the movie The Family Way. Ringo Starr went to spend time with his family, and George Harrison went to India to study under Ravi Shankar to develop his sitar playing. After this long vacation, the four got back together and in November of 1966 began the Sgt. Pepper recording sessions. What came out of these early sessions was the song Strawberry Fields Forever. Although this song was written before any other Sgt. Pepper song, it was not put on that album, instead being released as a single, and eventually being put on Magical Mystery Tour in November of 1967. The album begins with noise from a crowd and an orchestra. The guitar and drums then burst in and you're sucked into the world of Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band. Paul McCartney sings this song with a fantastic rock voice that doesn't seem to give up and stays strong through the entire song. It is interesting to note that although a crowd can be heard in this song, and in the reprise, this song was not recorded live. The crowd and orchestra sounds were added by George Martin, their producer. After the very rock-oriented opening, Ringo Starr gives his own personal touch to the album besides drumming, singing. Ringo Starr was known for not having many vocals on Beatles albums, his most famous before Sgt. Pepper being Yellow Submarine. Ringo hits a high note at the end, which probably wouldn't have existed without being encouraged by his other Beatles, and what a note it is. Every good album shouldn't be without controversy. Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds is one of those songs that makes controversy. Obviously, LSD is noticeable in the name, but an explanation behind this title was a drawing that John Lennon's son drew, and when asked the title, he replied, "Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds." Title aside, this song is filled with confusing lyrics. One playthrough isn't enough for this song, as the lyrics still confuse me. The song Getting Better is next, and all I really have to say about it is, it seems to be the most optimistic song I have ever heard.
I'm fixing a hole where the rain gets in and stops my mind from wandering where it will go.
Fixing a hole follows with a harpsichord at its heels. This really gives the song an at-home feel and makes it one of the best.
I'm feeling the cracks that run through. through the door and kept my mind from wandering where it will go. Wednesday morning at 5 o'clock, as the day begins.
She's Leaving Home is a very sad song of a girl who has just left home in the middle of the night, much to their parents' surprise, which is explained in the song. I would have to say that this is one of the saddest songs I've ever heard.
Kitchen clutching a handkerchief. Quietly turning the back door key.
After this very melancholy song, the circus-influenced Lennon song, Being for the Benefit of Mr. Kite, is heard. Very many things go into this song, as heard in the spiraling end. It is interesting to note that John Lennon got inspiration for this song from a poster he saw advertising a real festival. This is one of the more interesting songs, as it includes organs, bells, and a harmonica, really giving it that circus feel.
Celebrated Mr. K performs his feat on Saturday at Bishop's Gate.
Side 2 of the album is where things start to get a little different. Opening the second half is the very heavily Indian-influenced sitar piece Within You, Without You by George Harrison. This song is special because it was really the first time the sitar was heard by a famous rock group, although the sitar was used in Norwegian Wood on Rubber Soul and Tomorrow Never Knows on Revolver. I feel that this song left a bigger impact.
It's far too late when they pass away.
The mood then shifts completely to the clarinet-filled McCartney song, When I'm 64. The mood then shifts completely to the clarinet-filled McCartney song, When I'm 64. It is one of the best songs on the album, and one of the best McCartney songs of all time.
Still be sending me a Valentine. Birthday greetings, bottle of wine. If I be that.
Lovely Rita is a very catchy song with a nice piano solo, showing off how the Beatles could work outside of the box and use non-conventional rock instruments. Good Morning, Good Morning has odd time signature changes, going from 4-4 to 3-4 to even 5-4. And it really is a good song.
But what a day, how's your boy been? Nothing to do, it's up to you. I've got nothing to say but...
Almost bookending the album is the Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band song, with the next one being the reprise. Nothing new to say here, other than the fact that A Day in the Life follows it. Every great album should have a climax. This is the climax of climaxes. Filled with basically two different songs, this masterpiece ends with one of the most famous chords in music history. I'm talking about the giant E major chord, heard for at least a whole minute after it hits. It was performed by Lennon, McCartney, Ringo, assistant Mal Evans, and producer George Martin.